Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hey, well, good morning. Thanks for joining us for Kotaro Hara's presentation. So we're really excited to have Kotaro here today. He is just wrapping up his PhD in computer science at the University of Maryland, where he's been working on characterizing physical world accessibility at scale. So that's what he'll be talking with us about today. Kotaro has a really impressive set of achievements during his PhD. Lots of publications at venues like CHI and WIST and ASCII, including a recent Best Paper Award at Assets a couple years ago. He has also been recognized with a Google PhD Fellowship and an IBM PhD Fellowship. So we're really excited to have Kotaro here to talk to us today about all of his research in this area. Thanks.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you for inviting me here. I'm really excited to present my work today. So today, I will talk about how we can combine Google Street View, crowdsourcing, and other automated methods to collect a lot of information about physical accessibility. So in 1990s, the US Congress enacted Americans with Disabilities Act, which requires physical environment to be accessible for everyone. But in 2016, all the physical environment, like city streets and sidewalks, remain inaccessible for people with mobility impairments. And this is a huge problem because in the US, there are about 30 million people who have some kind of mobility impairments, of which 50 million people have used an assistive mobility aids, like wheelchairs or canes. Their mobility and independence is affected by problems like missing curb ramps. So without curb ramps, wheelchair users cannot get on and off the sidewalks. Or there are obstacles in riding in the middle of the sidewalk. You can just not pass the sidewalk. And there are surface problems, like degradation of surface, and there are vegetations, so on. And simply, there are no sidewalks sometimes. But the problem is not only that sidewalks and streets remain inaccessible, but also that there are no ways to identify which sidewalks are accessible for people with mobility impairments a priori. In fact, National Council of Disability noted that there's no way to identify accessible sidewalks. So we want to make applications like this. This is a visualization of accessibility of the city. So here, green areas show accessible areas for wheelchair users, and red areas show inaccessible areas. And if you click on a map, it shows rationale of why it's accessible or inaccessible. I think this is useful for people with mobility impairments. When they're moving to a new city, they have to choose where to live, and they want to live in an accessible neighborhood. Or we want to make applications like accessibility-aware navigation system. So this not only shows the shortest path from here to, say, Starbucks, but here to Starbucks in an accessible manner. But to make these kinds of applications, we need a lot of data, about accessibility of the street and sidewalk. So our goal, the goal of this decision project, is to really transform the way the street-level accessibility data is collected and enable new accessibility-aware GIS tools. So now, let me step back and introduce some few ways that this kind of street-level accessibility data is collected traditionally. So government organizations and volunteer organizations, they conducted walk audit. This basically means people go out and check whether sidewalks are accessible. But this is time-consuming, expensive, and it requires people to be on-site. Well, mobile technologies could reduce the costs. Applications like C-Click-Fix or New York City 311 allow people or citizens to report non-urgent neighborhood problems, which include some accessibility features like broken sidewalks. However, these tools still require people to be on site, and that limits the scalability of the data collection technique. And also, these tools are not specifically designed for accessibility data collection. Emerging tools like WheelMap or AccessMap are designed to collect accessibility data of businesses. But again, this requires people to be on site and it just reports wherever they have been before. So our approach is to use Google Street View to collect massive amount of accessibility data from the city. So in the rest of my talk, I will discuss four threads of my dissertation research. First, is it really feasible to use Google Street View to collect accessibility data? And if so, in the next two threads, I will talk about how can we scalably collect accessibility data from these images of Google Street View. And once we have massive data about accessibility of the city, how can we use it? What kind of tools can we design to support people with mobility impairments? So let's dive into each part. The first part, I will discuss, can we clearly observe accessibility problems in Street View images? And if so, does this accessibility information have value for people with mobility impairments? And do problems identified in Street View images reflect the current state of the physical world? So to answer first question, I just want to show you a video. So this is a Google Street View interface. You can dive into this world, and there's a surface problem. In College Park, there are missing curb ramps. This is New York. You can observe missing curb ramps again. And there's a tree right in the middle of the sidewalk, and there's a fire hydrant blocking the path, and pole again, and missing curb ramps, and so on. So by showing this, I hope I convinced you that this is a great source of information. You can actually see these problems that obstruct people from navigating the city. But is this, so we think this is important, but does it actually have value for people with mobility impairments? To answer this question, we actually interviewed 20 people with varying levels of mobility. We asked how do they plan a trip and assess the accessibility of their destinations a priori. And so the high level message, 11 out of 20 people already use street level imagery like Google Street View to assess the accessibility. So this is a great source of information, but I want to emphasize that this is not organized, this is not indexed, so you cannot search this information, and it's not readily available to integrate it into GIS tools. Okay, so that's good, but you may be wondering, does Google Street View actually reflect the current state of the physical world? So we don't exactly know how often Street View is updated, but anecdotally speaking, it gets updated monthly or yearly basis. So it could be outdated. But prior work in public health literature investigated concordance between Street View environment and physical environment and reported high level of agreement. But this was focused on features like cycling surface condition or parking and pedestrian infrastructure. So it was not really focused on accessibility. So we actually conducted similar research. We went out there and then investigated the accessibility concordance. We visited areas in 40 cities around Maryland, that's where I'm from, and took pictures of accessibility features. We then compared the picture of physical world that we took, the picture of the physical world that we took, and the Google Street View environment. Over the course of my dissertation project, we conducted two physical audits and surveyed 8 different accessibility features. But really, the high-level message is we observed high-level concordance. For example, when we looked at curb ramps and missing curb ramp features, we visited Washington, D.C. and Baltimore. We visited 273 intersections because that's where you're supposed to have curb ramps. It took 25 hours to walk around the cities. And the images, Google Street View images, were 2.2 years old, but we still observed more than 97% agreement between Street View and physical world. The small disagreement was due to construction. So to sum up, it is indeed feasible to use Google Street View.
You said it's due to construction. Mm-hmm. Is it, which direction was it? Was it that things that you felt were missing before actually were present?
Oh, so it was during the construction. There was a construction site, and then actually they were updating the So it was improving the...
They were improving.
Right. So, okay, so I hope I convinced this is a good source of information, but we have to extract accessibility features so that it's indexed, it's searchable. So how can we build interfaces to support minimally trained crowd workers to efficiently and accurately label accessibility problems? And are our perceptions towards accessibility problems consistent with people with mobility impairments? So actually, the strategies for doing efficient crowdsource is kind of holy grail for any kind of crowdsourcing research. And there are many ways to achieve this. For example, making efficient user interfaces, or break tasks down into microtasks, workflow adaptation, evaluation and feedback so people get better at doing tasks. But today, I'm going to talk about efficient user interface in this section. And later, in next section, I will talk about more about workflow control. So I want to stop here and ask you a question. So in this picture, what kind of accessibility problems do you see? Anyone?
Pole in the middle of the sidewalk.
Pole, right. Anything else?
There's no curb cut.
Right, so this is crosswalk, and then there's no curb cut at the end. Well, that's right. So that's basically what our tools ask users to do. So our image labeling task was four step. First, a user can find and mark the accessibility attributes. Then select the problem category, rate the problem severity, and submit the completed image. The interface asks.
Yes. On the accessibility problems you were looking
yes.
for.
Yes. For this interface, we show the video, telling okay what features we want them to find.
So in the interface, did they have a drop-down list of things that they
yes.
can select from?
Yeah.
Also add their own?
I'm going to show you the video, so hopefully it answers. So interface asked users to label missing curb ramp, an obstacle, surface problem, and prematurely ending sidewalk or no sidewalk. And in the early stage of this project, we created three different types of labeling interfaces to assess their interaction efficiency. First is point and click, where you just need to click on the feature. And second one is rectangle outline, in which you provide bounding box around the feature that you're interested in. The final one is polygonal outline that provides granular segmentation of the accessibility feature. And it has a trade-off. There's a trade-off between interaction speed and the pixel granularity. We want the interaction to be fast. But actually, when we conducted a preliminary crowdsourcing study for this, we looked at efficiency of the interfaces. We found that point and click was the fastest, but the actually polygonal outline that offered more granularity was not that slow. So for the subsequent studies, we used the polygonal interface, polygonal outline interface. And to answer your question, here's a video of the video of how the interface looked like. So at the middle, you can see Google Street View image, and there's a pole right in the middle of the sidewalk, so you can draw outline around it. And once you complete the outline, you can select what type of feature it is. And you can rate the severity and submit. Sometimes there's no problem, so you can report that too. And here are missing curb ramps, so you can draw outlines around it. Note that for missing curb ramps, we didn't ask them to provide severity because it's severe if you don't have it. To assess how accurately crowd workers can perform this task, we hired 185 workers from Amazon Mechanical Turk. We batched 1 to 10 image labeling tasks into one hit and paid 1 cent to 5 cents per hit. And for ground truth, three researchers individually labeled 229 static images of Street View, and we took majority vote to create the ground truth labels. So just to be on the same page for what Mechanical Turk is. Oh, yeah.
I have so about the ground truth. Mm-hmm. Since everyone's doing kind of the polygonal little image, how do you decide if people mark the same area? Is it just that some percent has to overlap?
I'll come back to it.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah. Just to show you what the Mechanical Turk is, or maybe everyone's aware of Mechanical Turk, but let me just explain. So, if you go to their webpage, you can see a list of small tasks. We call it micro tasks. And you can browse what the tasks are. They explain briefly what it is and also explain how much you get paid if you complete one task. You can click, and then it will navigate you to this interface. For example, this task is about transcribing the receipt. You can see the receipt on the right side, and you can use this interface to type in whatever the information is on the receipt. So of course, this is not our task. Our focus was to use this infrastructure to ask crowd workers to label accessibility problems in Google Street View. We asked crowd workers to watch video tutorial before conducting the task. So how can we build how accurately crowd workers perform this task? And actually, there are multiple ways to achieve high accuracy. It's called quality control methods. And there are multiple methods, for example, asking many people and taking majority vote, or asking people to verify other people's work, or filter out bad workers, using qualification. Or some people use Bayesian approach to filter out or assess how good the workers are or how good the tasks are. But here, we use majority vote because it's a commonly used quality control method, and it's very simple. So to look into the effect of Turker majority vote on accuracy, we made a groups of 3, 5, 7, and 9 Turkers. And note that it's not really common to recruit like 7 or 9 Turkers, but we did it for evaluation. So majority vote, what does it do? Let me show you an example. Here, let's say one worker provided low quality labels, and we want to filter it out. And if you take majority vote, then we can filter out because they do not agree with 2 other people. So how should we evaluate Turker labels? And there are multiple ways to do this. So in this scene, there are 2 poles standing in the middle of sidewalk, and there's a missing curb ramp. Let's say Turker only labeled these 2 poles. If you look at this table, we can say what problems they label. So in the image level, they got 3 out of 4 accuracy. But as you said, we can also assess the accuracy in terms of pixel level. So did these labels overlap with ground truth labels? This is useful to train object detection algorithms. So different ways of So for example, image level label is sufficient for assessing whether there are problems in sidewalk. And pixel level provides more granular location of the problems. And also, it can be fed into the computer vision training. But for this part, I will only talk about image level accuracy to assess the efficacy of using crowdsourcing to collect accessibility data. Because if you cannot do image level accurately, then there's no hope of doing pixel level correctly. And this graph shows average image level accuracy of the label with number of Turkers. So x-axis is the number of Turkers that are bundled into majority vote. And y-axis is accuracy. So with 1 Turker, the accuracy was 78.3%. But as we took majority vote, the accuracy went up. But after 5 Turkers, majority vote, accuracy kind of saturated. So it's probably enough to recruit 5 people to get accurate data. I want to show you a few examples to contextualize the results. So here, missing curb ramps. People were in general good at finding these features, but sometimes they made mistakes. So here's a missing curb ramp, and they labeled it correctly, but they also labeled this stop sign, even though it's on the grass and it's not really obstructing the pass. So they are over-labeling. And sometimes people are really confused and provide random labels. Although we could take majority vote and filter out these bad labels, it would be nice if you can get higher quality labels. Okay, so moving on to the next part, are our perceptions towards accessible problems agree with people with mobility impairments? So we want to see if our ground truth is actually what people with mobility impairments consider as problems. To answer this, we recruited 3 wheelchair users. They independently label 75 subset of Street View images. Then we measured agreement between researchers' labels and wheelchair users' labels. Here's an example recording from the study session.
Okay. Definitely this utility pulls an object in path. Okay, object in path. I'd say that's a 5.
So actually, 2 out of 3 wheelchair users had upper body mobility impairments as well. So research assistant helped them label the accessibility features. And as a result, we observed strong agreement between wheelchair users and researchers, which means we share similar perspective towards what constitutes accessibility problems. Yeah.
Good question. So when you were asking people to identify these problems, were they identifying them for themselves or for the community?
We asked them to consider you're the user.
And so when you get to the strong agreement, is that referring to just, you know, the presence or absence of different things, like there's an object in path, yes or no, or was there also strong agreement on the severity rating?
We didn't look into severity, but we just looked at presence of obstacles or missing curb ramps and so on. Any other questions? Okay.
What did you want to use severity for?
Excuse me?
When did you want to use severity for?
Severity, so for example, severity matters for people with mobility, people who use wheelchair. Like even there is a curb cut, sometimes it's really like cracked or there's some vegetation and it's really not usable. And then people can say, okay, it's really severe problem. It's like a combination of curb ramp and surface problem. Or sometimes you're not sure if some pole is really blocking the path. Then you can say, okay, this is not, maybe not severe because it looks passable, but you're not sure.
That's the idea, but you just haven't used that data yet.
Right.
Okay.
So, right, we can use crowdsourcing and collect accessibility data. But we all know for the system to be truly scalable, we need to combine some computation. So in this part, I will discuss, can we employ computer vision to automatically and accurately detect accessibility attributes? And unfortunately, the answer is no, because computer vision, it's a still developing area of research. And it's not perfect yet. So the next question is, how can we combine crowdsourcing and computer vision to efficiently and accurately collect data? So let me step back and introduce some related work. Using computer vision to characterize and understand street-level environment is an increasingly popular area of research. For example, NAIC investigated methods or using computer vision and street view images to automatically assess the aesthetics or safety of the neighborhoods. Here's a video. This is called street score. Here, green dots mean safe areas, and red dots mean unsafe area. You can click each point and see an abstract safety score that were automatically calculated using computer vision. So this kind of application is great. But street score helps us to understand high-level understanding of the neighborhood safety, we need more granular data about accessibility to understand which sidewalks are accessible and also why, which requires finding and classifying accessibility attributes in images. This is a common object detection and classification task. Since, as I said, object detection is an active area of research, it's not really perfect. So it has been really common to use hybrid approach. For example, Su et al. Introduced the workflow where an object detection algorithm detects objects, like bottles, and humans can verify outputs. For example, they can say, OK, this red box, this is not a bottle. So this is great because it's more accurate compared to computer vision alone, but it's cheaper than asking humans to label everything. However, one limitation is some object never gets labeled if the first stage computer vision misses this object detection. Another way of increasing data collection efficiency is to optimize crowd workflow. There are different methods, including varying the number of workers to recruit depending on task difficulty, or assigning stronger, better workers to more difficult tasks so you can optimize globally. And reducing the tasks that require human work by triaging, or changing the task interface completely based on worker characteristics. And our work is, we introduced a semi-automated system called Tome that uniquely combines what I explained, crowdsourcing, computer vision, and all the workflow controllers to get data efficiently. And for this part of the talk, I will focus on detecting curb ramps because, well, it's an important feature for wheelchair users. And also, that was a good starting point for us for dealing with computer vision because it's more visually salient compared to other features like surface problems. Tome combines multiple components. So let me first give you the overview of the system. And
yeah. Do the curb cuts always have that orange part in it?
No. So it varies in design.
If it did, then it would be easy to
Right. It's easier.
It's
but even then, in a picture, it looks different based depending on the rotation, like where you're looking at, or sometimes curb ramps are really far away. I will touch on that later. So Tome combines multiple components. It collects data sets, including, well, Street View images and top-down map image, GIS metadata, 3D depth map. We train an automatic curb ramp detector. And now we have a decision point. We have automatic controller, which predicts computer vision performance. If we predict that computer vision performed well, then we pass the task to cheaper manual verification workflow. But if we predict that computer vision failed, then we pass the task to more accurate but expensive manual labeling workflow. But how do we define computer vision failure? So for this, let me show you an example. This is a picture of one corner of the intersection. We apply computer vision technique, and it detects curb ramp. So this is a correct detection, but there are false positive detections, and more importantly, there is a false negative. So computer vision doesn't detect curb ramp. And this is a very expensive mistake because basically we have to ask people to relabel this. Let me give you an example of how the system works. So here's a Google Street View image. We apply computer vision detector, and here, the controller extracts features that are useful to assess whether computer vision performed well or not. And if we think it passes, if it performed well, then we pass the task to manual verification, which is cheaper. Another example, so computer vision detects curb ramps, task controller extracts features and assess if fails, then it passes the task to manual labeling. Then let's dive into details. I'm going to explain component by component. Our web scraper collects Street View images. We get data from intersections because that's basically where we find curb ramps. We also download the accompanying 3D point cloud data and Street View metadata, which includes the cardinality of the intersection. Also top-down Google Maps imagery. And we use this data to train curb ramp detector and also the task controller. And we can repeat this for all the intersections we looked at. And as Corey said, because sidewalk infrastructure can vary in design and appearance, we looked at different cities in multiple countries, including, well, DC, that's where I live, and Baltimore, Los Angeles, and Saskatoon in Canada. We also looked at different areas in each city, downtown and residential area. So these are where we looked at. In total, we had 11.3 kilometers, square kilometers, and there were 1,086 intersections. We found 2,877 curb ramps and 647 missing curb ramps. Average Street View image age was 2.2 years old. Yeah.
And when you say the number of curb ramps and missing curb ramps, that's you guys manually
labeled
that.
Yeah, we labeled.
Okay.
So using the collected street view images, two researchers labeled curb ramps in our dataset, and we found 2,877 curb ramp labels. So here's a set of examples. And using these image patches of curb ramp pictures, we trained the automatic curb ramp detector. Curb ramp detection was a three-stage process. We first had the object detection algorithm called deformal part model. And second part was post-processing to filter out errors. And third part was SVM-based classification for output refinement. We experimented with various object detection algorithms, and we chose to use a framework called deformal part model, or DPM. It performed the best in the internal assessment, and it is one of the most successful object detection algorithms. What it does is it models the target object's main body and also the parts using histogram of oriented gradient features. And it also models the relative relationship, positional relationship of all the parts. So here's the example. With DPM alone, we can detect these. So red boxes show the curb ramps that DPM thought are curb ramps. And here I show a number of curb label. There's one curb ramp over there, and there aren't any other. So if you look at it, there are multiple redundant detection boxes, and also there are curb ramps in the sky, which we shouldn't have. We can filter these mistakes using techniques like non-maximum suppression or using the 3D point cloud data. So with the 3D point cloud data, we can filter out curb ramps in the sky. Yeah.
So why is it only one curb? It looks like there's two curb ramps.
So this is a driveway. We didn't count.
Driveways don't count?
Right, we don't count it as curb ramp.
Why not?
Because it's not really a curb ramp. We could.
It's navigable by a person in a wheelchair, though.
That's true. Well, it's kind of a decision we made. And also, we don't really want to make navigation application and tell them, hey, there's a driveway so you can use it.
There's no crosswalk or gap.
Right. So. Right, so we use 3D depth data. And in the last stage, to refine the detection results further, we use features like color histogram in the box and their positions, the bounding box's position and size. And this is the result we get. There's one correct curb ramp and there are three false positives. Here's another example. So with DPM alone, we get this kind of result. With post-processing, we can refine the data. And with the last part refinement, we can get better data. So how accurate is computer vision component alone? To assess this, we use twofold cross-validation. And I'm going to show you the precision recall curve of how detector worked. The y-axis is precision, and x-axis is recall. It's a precision recall curve, so we want to push this curve towards the top right corner and maximize the area under the curve. So here's the result. With DPM alone, we had area under the curve of 0.48. With post-processing, it increased to 0.5. And with the last stage SVM, it went up slightly to 0.53. But notice that more than 20% of curb ramps were never detected. And just to put this into context, with one human worker, we could achieve precision of 84% and recall of 88%. So computer vision alone is not sufficient to accurately find curb ramp data. And we found some common causes that computer vision struggled. So let me just go over it. So sometimes we saw occlusions. So here, people are in front of curb ramps, so we cannot fully see the curb ramps. And sometimes there are illumination problems. Like here, shadows are casting on the curb ramps, which makes the detection harder. Also, there's a scaling issue. So some curb ramps are really close by, and some are really far away. So far away curb ramps, you can only use this much of pixels to detect them. And also, there are viewpoint variation. Well, different curb ramps, they are facing different directions, so it looks different because of the rotation. And also, there's a high-level question of, should we consider curb or driveway as curb ramp or not? So the computer vision struggle with this. And also, curb ramp design varied between cities, like LA and DC. So that's why computer vision is not performing perfectly, and that's why we want to combine it with crowdsourcing. Now we have computer vision output, how do we predict how well they performed? So our workflow controller used the following features, including number of streets that are connected to the intersections, and depth data. And it is useful because you can estimate how far each sidewalks are, and if sidewalks are far away, as I said, there are only a limited number of pixels to use for detection. And we also downloaded the top-down images and used it as a feature because we can use it as a proxy for complexity of the intersection. Here, the one intersection on the left is arguably easier compared to the one on the right. Of course, we had computer vision output at this point, so we also used that as a feature. So we counted the number of bounding boxes that are detected and also their confidence values.
Just a question. I must have missed this earlier. Where did you get your depth data from?
So Street View actually has this data. It's not really a precise data compared to actual panoramic image, but they still have this. You can collect it.
There's just some metadata that Google Street View provides.
Yeah. So right, so using all these features, we performed the linear classification, binary classification, and separated them into whether they passed or failed. And if they failed, then we passed a task to more accurate but expensive manual labeling workflow. We basically asked crowd workers to use this interface where they could pan around and then see the intersection environment, and we asked them to label curb ramps. We collected the highly granular information to train computer vision algorithms furthermore. So for the first-time workers, we showed this tutorial. It taught them how to use the interface step-by-step and what features we wanted them to collect. And also, here we inserted some tasks with ground truth labels. So if a person made an error, then interface instructed what was wrong and how to fix these mistakes. And if the controller predicted the task was easy, the computer vision performed well, then we passed the task to manual verification workflow, which was cheaper. Here you can see green boxes, which shows the detection, computer vision detection, and you can just click on it to delete if they're not actually on curb ramps. So, can we combine crowdsourcing and computer vision to increase the data collection efficiency? We measured it. We compared the performance of manual labeling, computer vision plus verification workflow, and Tome, which integrates the task workflow controller. We looked at accuracy and task completion time. We recruited workers from Amazon Mechanical Turk, and we used 1,046 Google Street View images for assessment. And Turkers completed over 6,300 labeling tasks and 4,800 verification tasks. And we used Monte Carlo simulation to assess this. And here, on the left, I want to show you accuracy and cost on the right-hand side. We want accuracy to be high and cost to be low. So here you go. With manual labeling alone, we performed 84% precision and 88% recall and 86% F measure. The cost was 94 seconds per image. his computer vision plus verification alone. Precision was 68%, and two other measures also decreased, primarily because of the false negative errors. But the cost was much cheaper, actually more than twice cheaper compared to manual labeling. And here is Tome. So if you combine workflow controller, we can achieve similar accuracy, but with reduction in cost of 13%. So how did our task controller work, or how did it perform? I just want to give you the high-level result. So actually, the 390 tasks that were passed to manual labeling could have been passed to verification. They didn't contain any false negative errors. And 60 images should have been routed to labeling. So this shows that our controller is kind of being too conservative. And if we can improve it and make a perfect controller, then Tome's cost would drop by 28% of manual labeling approach, and without sacrificing any accuracy. No.
Are you including the cost of computation?
Well, we just say computation is free because it's much faster compared to manual labeling.
It's not actually free, but
yeah, that's true. Okay. All right, 28% is good. We're happy, but how can we further improve this? We want to make this orders of magnitude better. So I'll talk about future work later, how to improve this by, well, improving the object detection algorithms or designing better interfaces for talkers. All right.
Could you just mention one number? If you were to do Manhattan or something like that, how much would it cost?
So I don't know about Manhattan. I can't get it for DC.
For DC.
It's a mid-sized city. It takes about 150 hours for one worker without any workflow controller or anything. We can just walk around in Google GPU and label everything. And it's parallelizable. We can just recruit 1,000 people on Amazon Mechanical Turk. So actually, without any task controller, we can achieve pretty good results. But if we want to scale it to entire US or maybe entire areas that we have Google GPU, then we want to do some smart thing to increase efficiency.
What's the dollars? How many dollars?
Oh, dollars? It depends on how much you pay to Turkers,
yeah,
but if
given,
you
given
pay,
what you pay.
We pay the minimum wage like $7 per hour, so it's less than $1,000 for DC. So if you want to have, so that's only for one worker, but if you want to do majority vote, then maybe we have to recruit 3 people, so the cost increases, but the order of magnitude is pretty much same.
So it's maybe tens of millions to do the US.
Maybe, yeah. Okay.
It's not a lot, really.
Right.
In the scheme of things, that's...
That's true. If we have enough money, then we can...
Less to the city than probably to install one curb cut, right?
Right. That's true, yeah. Okay, so once we have this unprecedented level of information about street accessibility, then how can we use it? So to answer these questions, we recruited 20 people with varying levels of mobility, and their age ranged from 19 to 77. 13 used smartphones. And the study was a two-stage process. First, the participants worked on scenario-based design, where they were asked to brainstorm and sketch the desired assist technologies of the future. We gave them 3 scenarios to facilitate a brainstorming task. And one of the scenarios looked like this. I'm going to read it out. So you're planning to rent a room in an unfamiliar city that you will be moving to in a few months. Imagine that there's a website that provides accessibility information about the city. What should that website look like? We provided them 4 templates to sketch prototypes. Right. And then second part of the study, we performed design probe, in which we basically asked to critique the prototypes, paper prototypes that we designed. The paper prototypes included, for example, sidewalk level accessibility visualization, which showed where we have sidewalks and how accessible they are. We also had accessibility aware search tool, basically Yelp, which tells which neighborhood is accessible and you can search based on that. We extracted 10 desired features from all the sketches that people drew and also the critique that they provided to our designs, and also 6 data qualities. And I'm just going to talk about 3 design features. Here's a prototype that one participant sketched. And one key feature she wanted was visualization of accessible route from point A to point B. Okay. But moreover, she wanted us to show precise locations and what types of accessibility features are there. Because in that way, she can say, oh, okay, this accessibility feature actually matters, this doesn't matter. So we can, you know, choose which route to take. And also, it would be nice to show pictures to confirm these data, and also the description of the detailed description of what accessibility features they are. Right, to sum up, in the first part, we examined the viability of using street view imagery as an accessibility data source. In the second part, we designed, developed, and evaluated novel methods and crowd-powered systems to collect sidewalk accessibility data. Third part, we developed a new method of combining crowdsourcing and computation methods to improve data collection efficiency. And the last part, explored the desired features and data qualities of future accessibility tools. Yeah.
So did you actually build the accessibility tools?
I'm planning to build it for my dissertation project. And that's kind of what I want to show now. So I'm going to show you what I have or we have built. So we're trying to deploy this interface. So previously, we relied on crowdsourcing from crowd workers from Amazon Mechanical Turk. But we're planning to deploy it to public, so both paid crowd workers and volunteers can participate. So here, you can see Shuri pictures, and you can navigate. And here are features that we want people to find, like curb ramps, missing curb ramps, obstacles, surface problem, and some other features like no sidewalk. And if you look around, here you can see crosswalk, but actually there's no curb ramp. So you can, let me just mute it. So okay, here's a missing curb ramp, and it's severe, so you can rate it as not passable. All right, and we can zoom out. And if you pan a little bit, there's missing curb ramp again. So you can label it, and you can mark it as severe problem. Here's a curb ramp, so you can label that. Here's another curb ramp, so you can label that again. So I want to show that it keeps track of what you have labeled. And also, the label that you provided, it gets mapped to lat-long position, so you can see where exactly on the map you have these problems or facilitators like curb ramps. And here's a poll. This is probably OK. You can probably go around it, but I'm just going to label it and say passable. And just say this is probably passable. So later, when we can ask people to actually see and decide on themselves that this is passable or not. And here's a surface problem over here. So we can label that. You can go around here, but I'm just going to label it. It's this is passable, but it needs fix or something like that. And we tell them to follow this red line to keep walking along the road, and you get the idea. You keep walking and then find these accessibility features. So yeah.
So how are you generating these? Where does this path come from?
So we download the street network data from mm-hmm. OpenStreetMap, and then we segment it into pieces, mm-hmm. and we provide walkers to follow it.
Can you also provide information whether other people have gone down the same path? It's kind of like just to see how they agree with other people.
That's a good idea. We don't do it right now, but we could definitely do that. Yeah.
This looks like it's an interface for volunteers to label things. Is this what the interface would also look like for the end user who has the mobility challenge, who wants to see their path
on
their route?
For the path, so this is for data collection. And if you want, so we can use this data, this lot long positions of accessibility features to make, well, you can make anything with it.
But you haven't made a consumption site yet.
That's
right,
what I was
we
wondering.
Haven't. Right, we haven't made consumption. Well, actually, you can see, you can go to the dashboard and then see what. Oops. Okay, let me sign in. Oops. Well, this is already on the web server, but I haven't really deployed it, so it's only pretty much only me who has worked on this. But for example, this is Washington, DC, and these block segments shows where I have audited. And if you, so I've audited extensively in these two neighborhoods. So this already visualizes which areas are more accessible. So green things shows curb ramps, and red label shows missing curb ramp, blue label shows obstacle in pass, and orange is surface problem. So here you don't really have accessibility problems, but this neighborhood is disastrous. You have a lot of obstacles, surface problem, and so on. And you can actually browse it and already make some decision. So if you're on wheelchair and if you want to go to this neighborhood, you should plan better. You can go there with your caregiver, your friends, or your family, or you can request some paratransit to go to this neighborhood.
I think also what would be ideal if you could enter your start point and end point and almost kind of like have a checkbox where you say that, okay, I want to also include these program considerations and then have a path that's kind of chopped out that way.
True.
And maybe with the severity level, so some paths you might still be able to pass through.
Yeah.
And then allow that to be, if someone has severe impairments, maybe they need completely clean path versus with someone who has less severe needs.
True.
So you could make that also on a scale.
Yeah, and they can decide whether they want to take that path or not. Yeah.
Can you go back to the previous view where you were, where you were labeling?
Yeah. Let me just go to the same page.
So what? Tell us about the achievements. What is the achievements
area? This is kind of a fun factor. So we just wanted to give feedback on how much streets you have walked, and also for each neighborhood, how much you have contributed. For second means you're second place in this neighborhood, and 0 miles means I haven't walked so much in this neighborhood yet. So it's just a little thing.
The interface where you get to see the general condition of the neighborhood is really, really good. When you're talking about the scenario with it, I'm going to move to an area.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to me like the path between the apartment you're going to rent and the bus stop
mm-hmm.
is something you would just go on Street View and you look very carefully yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You might not use the tool. You just want to see exactly what the challenges were along the way.
That's true.
Yeah.
Right. So I think that's what people do right now. So if they know where exactly they're going, or they know the point of interest already, then they can use Google Street View. And in fact, that's what they do. But the idea is we want to index all the accessibility data geographically so they can search or they can quickly browse which neighborhoods are accessible if they're deciding where to live. Great question. Yeah.
Sorry, I came in a little late. Sorry about that. Maybe talk about this. But thinking about this from sort of the urban planning perspective,
mm-hmm. I will touch
on
that in future work, but yes,
okay.
I haven't talked about it.
Oh, you're getting, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, I thought you were wrapping up. Okay, so I'll hold off then.
All right. All right. Then actually, let me wrap up then. So, yeah. All right. So what are we really looking at? As I said, there is a total distance of streets in Washington, D.C. is about 1,238 miles. And based on my data, how much I took to audit, the audit speed is 7.9 miles per hour. So we can calculate that it takes about 157 hours to label entire DC, which is not too bad. And we can do this better using some automation or doing some smart work planning.
That's a driving audit or a street view.
Oh, audit as in like using this interface to walk around and label accessibility features. All right. And all of my work has primarily focused on collecting data to support people with mobility impairments. We can imagine using this for different purposes. Like, and actually, I have worked on collecting bus stop accessibility data. So people with visual impairments, they use landmarks like poles and shelters and benches to identify, localize where bus stops are so they can decide where to stand. Or we can use this for collecting where trees are so local government can keep track of where they have to maintain trees. Or public health, we can assess how clean cities are. Or urban planning, like we can figure out which streets have bicycle paths or any other things. Right, so there are things that I want to do for the rest of my PhD and in the future. As I said, I want to make applications, but we want to make this access score, which shows accessible neighborhoods and inaccessible neighborhoods. But this is probably useful for people with mobility impairments, but can we use it to other purpose, like estimating how healthy the neighborhoods are, or can we influence real estate value based on this data? We have also started designing accessibility aware navigation system. And one undergrad, Zach Lawrence, he's working with me. He started designing tools that are accessible for wheelchair users. Because when manual wheelchair users are navigating, they have to push wheelchairs. And they don't have hands free. So can we design this accessibility aware navigation tool that is also accessible to use? All right. And as I said, we can do smart things to make this process more efficient. Like, can we triage and plan the data collection so that we can efficiently collect data? Or can we react to user needs? So once we create this kind of navigation app, can we react to what people requested? If they want to go to point B to A or A to B, can we collect data along the path? Or can we just make more efficient interface where you can, say, verify whatever other people have labeled quickly? So we created this game where you can see pictures, image patches of what has labeled. Or can we make kind of a hyperlapse kind of interface where we force people to go really quickly and then quickly label everything? I also want to keep working on the computer vision aspect. So can we use more of a 3D contextual information to increase the accuracy of computer vision performance? And yeah.
What's mensuration?
Oh, mensuration means measuring the distance. And for example, obstacles, finding obstacles is kind of a subjective task. So even if you have fire hydrant in the middle of a sidewalk, we don't know if it's an obstacle, per se. Like, does it have enough space next to it? If we have, then it's not really obstacles. So we want to measure how much distance it has. Right. Another area that I'm kind of interested is how can we react to changes? So we discussed the infrastructures like curb cuts or permanent objects. They don't really change over time. But if you think about construction, it pops up one day and then goes away in 1 week, right? So how can we react to that kind of information? Can we use data like satellite images that gets updated every day? Or can we reappropriate video surveillance video that is taking the real-time information? All right, so I worked on other things over the course of my PhD. And I worked with Shamsi on the design of the translation system. And also, I worked with other professors on monolingual translation project. So if you have any question, I can answer that. And I want to thank collaborators, advisor my advisor John and other professors and researchers, also all the students that I worked with. Thank you.
So we have time for more questions if anyone has other questions. And if anyone's watching on the videotape, you can type in your questions and I'll ask them for you.
Yeah.
So this is the broader issue of what is the state of my city and what is the state of sidewalks, and is something that actually affects a lot of stakeholders, right? Mm-hmm. And so I'm wondering what work you guys have done to think about, are there other ways, other data sources that you can tap into, or other people who would be motivated to generate this kind of data or similar data that might be useful?
Right. So yeah, I interviewed people with mobility impairments, and we discussed, would you be interested in like contributing to this task of collecting all the data? And they were excited, and they said their families or their caregivers would be also interested. So that could be one. We haven't really done any study, so we haven't evaluated it, but we want to study that too.
Right. So one that comes to mind just is thinking about bike culture. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people who ride bikes in the city think a lot about accessibility of different areas and things.
Right.
And also they move around a lot.
That's
of the city
true.
Very quickly. So.
Yeah.
But I suspect there are other, stakeholders or, and thinking about like my own neighborhood, I want my own neighborhood to be like, neighborhood watch people.
Right.
Or rather than writing down when like a suspicious person comes in, oh yeah, here is problems.
Yeah. That's true. It's a great idea.
As a follow-up to that, the navigation system waves, and I can indicate when there's a police officer there or where there's an obstacle there, sort of as I'm going by it. Again, if it's an accessibility issue,
mm-hmm.
it's very apparent to the person that runs across it if there's an easy way for them to report.
Right.
Has there been any work in...
So in the related work section, I talked about some applications, like mobile applications, where you can report some neighborhood problems, like cracked sidewalks. It's a great idea. So we want to combine all the data like as much as possible.
Mm-hmm.
One problem is people have to be there to report that. So it kind of limits the scalability. And also people get bored using that. Whereas this, you can just sit down in front of a computer and contribute like 5 minutes from your office desk. And it scales better. So I think it kind of complements each other.
So one thing that you didn't talk a lot about here was the connection with the actual policy people.
Right.
So you're going to create all this data, which is great,
mm-hmm.
and it says, this is really shitty accessibility, this is good accessibility.
Mm-hmm.
But that actually is not going to be particularly reinforcing to anybody who's doing the volunteer work here
mm-hmm.
if, in fact, nothing ever happens.
Right.
When they are labeling the stuff, et cetera. So have you started talking or had any conversations government, et cetera?
Yeah. So actually I talked with DC DOT people, and they're really excited about this project because they don't have this data. They have some information like where streets are, but they don't know like which sidewalks are accessible, where we have missing curb ramps, like where we have surface problems. So they want to use that data to, sometimes better plan to allocate, money to fix sidewalks and so on. So yeah, I didn't really talk about it, but we started talking to those people.
I think one thing that's interesting to explore there
mm-hmm.
is how you feed this back to people.
Yeah.
Like, I do a big bunch of stuff in my neighborhood, and one of the things I think would be really valuable for me is to know that somebody actually paid attention to that.
That's true, yeah.
And there's something that got fixed and changed, and that actually could be potentially really strongly reinforcing
mm-hmm.
for your users as well.
That's true, yeah. Yeah, and yeah, I guess that's a great idea. We should. Yeah.
So your focus has been mostly on the labeling and the data collection and kind of like building up the system.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if you had any ideas on the consumption side, that what you would consider as a success and what kind of metrics you would use to say that, okay, so once people start using the data, so
mm-hmm.
how would you evaluate that this is something that helps them?
How to evaluate? Sorry, can you elaborate?
It's kind of like helping evaluate that once they have all this curb information, so versus what they have now, which is basically...
Oh, whether is our data better than
yes.
what exists now? We haven't really. And primarily because many cities, with few exceptions, they don't really have this kind of data at all. So for example, DC is doing really good job of collecting like where curb ramps are, but they don't have where missing curb ramps are or where surface problems are. And they don't have data with this granularity, like severity ratings. So I'm not really sure how to compare the quality of this data compared to existing data. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, it would be interesting to think about how people would eventually use it. I mean, one is that using it is not the problem, but it's kind of like, okay, so do they find having this information, are they coming up with better routes? Is it more satisfactory to kind of like, oh yeah, so this has the information about all the curb ramp or the missing curb ramp, so I'm going to pick this one and that makes my commute more enjoyable or easy or something along those lines, that it's actually helping people in some sense.
Right, so yeah, that's why I interviewed people who use wheelchairs or canes. And actually I can point you to the paper that describes all the desired features or how they would like to use this data, which describe, I hope that answered your question.
What would be the frequency of use of that? So you gave the example that, okay, I'm planning to move to a neighborhood. So clearly that's a big major life decision. And I think Ed had said that you probably like go look at these things sort of in person for something of that scale.
Mm-hmm.
Where how often are people now going in and looking at a Google Map for it, some place they're visiting or for some other type of, is this the daily type of thing, monthly?
So moving, well, actually, I don't know the exact answer to that. I don't know how often they move around. But so daily things like traveling to just for travel, like, okay, I want to go to Boston this weekend. We can use that. We can use, it's kind of a similar scenario, right? Like you want to decide which hotel to stay, which attractions to go. So we can use this data for that too. Did I answer your question?
You know, I think in terms of evaluating the impact, I mean, certainly in the end, what you care about is the people who are actually using these improvements in the city. But you might be easier, just have more luck showing that you can make the city planners and whatnot more efficient than what they do, right? It just might be kind of easier. You know, like, well, actually, in your talks with the folks at DC, like, how do they decide now where to put a curb cut?
That's a good question. Actually, I don't know.
You know, I mean, if it's just, like in theory, you could use your system and go, you know, DC is only 72% efficient in terms of like, you know, 28% of the time or whatever, you know, people have to take an alternate route because they're lacking, you know, right, the appropriate infrastructure. And so you can make them, you know, probably way more efficient would be my guess.
Well, I think one of the issues here, I know, is that like all this stuff, they're legally bound to have. So there's all this stuff that's missing.
Right.
That they're supposed to have by law. And so then the question is, how do they prioritize which ones
are going to improve their privacy? I mean, you know how governments work. I bet you can improve their privatization by like orders of magnitude, would be my guess.
Yeah. You could enforce a lot of change.
Yeah.
The other thing is, again, it comes down to, it's common in lots of different areas of software where the number of people with accessibility issues is smaller, so getting the penetration sort of use is more difficult. But you could combine it with other features that are important sort of for everybody, so for sidewalks. Okay?
Right.
So I would imagine any place you have a sidewalk, you're going to want a curb cut on either end. So getting data also on the sidewalks where more people might be have an intrinsic motivation for getting those labeled properly.
Right, that's true.
You might be able to leverage
more people to contribute.
Yeah.
Right, that's a great point. Yeah.
So in talking to you and John about this stuff in the past in terms of the data collection from crowd workers, it seems like one of the things, the decisions that you made was err on the side of collecting too much data. So severity rating as a 5-point scale and the polygons, and I'm wondering, just, do you have a sense, having now done this for a couple of years, which of that data is really useful and which of that data you could just say, well, actually, if we just click on probable problem areas and we don't worry about the severity and we don't worry about the polygon, is that enough? And is that,
Okay, so severity, we don't really know. We haven't asked or used in any application to check whether it's really necessary. We think it's necessary because people rate different things differently. So I don't have good sense. So polygons, we need it for training computer vision if we want to do that. So that's important. But I don't really have a good answer to your question.
So it's just something to look at later in the future.
Do you have any existing plans for exploring the severity stuff? I mean, I think this is a really interesting question because this is a lot of extra data, extra clicks that you have to do. You've got all this stuff. And you seem to have some intuition that it's a really, but you haven't used it yet.
Right, yes.
And so what do you want to use it for? Do you have specific plans for that? And what's your first thing you want to do?
So for example,
and
people
how
have...
valid, I mean, what's the validity
and,
of that,
right.
the accuracy of that data? I mean, if people's ratings are all over the place.
Yeah, so the thing is people have different view towards how severe problems are, right? Like maybe I say like this is 5, this is really severe, but people say, man, it's like 3. So how can we, kind of normalize it so that we know we know how severe it is, and you can present it to users. And maybe we can use traditional method of like testing theory or item response theory to kind of assess how so we can assess like bias of myself, my bias and then other users' bias. So it would be interesting research area to
I wonder too if you the way that you scope that where you say we're looking for all potential issues, from very low, not really a problem to a severe problem.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, tweaking that in terms of the design of the task could also really affect the precision and recall of that, right? I mean, if my task is I'm going to get everything that could be, well, I now I'm a crowd worker and I imagine, oh gosh, what if some grandma is going in her wheelchair and, well, we better just tag this just to be safe, right? So you can imagine just the way that you frame that actually does affect what comes back through. Whereas if you didn't provide that, or if you filtered out those low severity tasks, something you might get, you'll do interesting things with the data set.
True. So yeah, I haven't done anything with severity, but I guess I agree. It's an interesting area of research.
Well, thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you very much.